particularly we can calculate like how a market went for that particular period of time, if whether it is for a particular day, particular week, a month, or a particular year. Now, talking about trade settlement, like whenever you buy or sell a share through any broker, the settlement takes place by T plus 2 working days, wherein T stands for trading day and followed by 2 working days. So if you will buy a particular stock today, it will be in your account only, but it will get reflected in your Demat account after today, and after like if you buy it today, it will deflect in your Demat account after 2 days. The same way, there is a term used in stock markets that is pay in and pay out. Pay in day is the day when the stock brokers shall make payment or delivery of securities to the exchange, whereas pay out day is the day when exchange makes payment or delivery of securities to the broker. For this, I will like to tell you something. Say if today you purchase a share of Reliance, what will happen is your balance won't get deducted today itself. The balance will be deducted tomorrow. So tomorrow will be your pay in day. Pay in day when broker will make payment on your behalf to the one from whom he is purchasing that particular stock. In the same way, if you are selling the particular stock today, tomorrow your broker will receive a payment, and he will say he won't receive the payment. He will firstly deliver the stocks from his account to the person, like to the exchange. Then exchange will transfer the particular share in the account of a person or a broker who is on a buy position. The same way, pay out day is the day when exchange makes payment or delivery of securities. If you are buying a particular share today, after 2 days, the exchange will receive your payment and will transfer the shares in your Demat account. Now, a very common term which is used is portfolio. Whenever you buy any share, the same share is reflected in your portfolio, and the hold price update in portfolio is inclusive of brokerage and taxes. If you are trading or investing in stock markets, you will be able to see that you placed a market order for, say, a particular stock at rupees 100, but it won't be shown in your portfolio as only rupees 100. It will be shown as 100 rupees plus whatever the brokerage charges your broker charged for that particular transaction, plus all the taxes like STTs, GST, and there are various other charges. So all the prices will be collected, and then whatever the final price is received, it will be shown in your portfolio. The same way, like we talked about here, about brokerage. So what is brokerage? Brokerage is nothing but a charge that your broker or the broking agency charges to you for every buy and sell transaction. Every one of us know that the stock market works from 9:30, 9:15 to 3:30 only. But these are the actual market hours, where from 9 a.m. to 9:15 a.m. it is treated as pre-opening market session. In this time slot of 9 a.m. to 9:15 a.m., from 9 a.m. to 9:07, only orders are placed. From 9:07 to 9:11, the orders which were placed earlier are now matched. Like, say if someone named X has placed an order of buying Reliance at, say, rupees 100, another person is there named Y who has placed a sell order of Reliance only at rupees 100. These sort of the orders are matched during this particular time slot. After that, 9:11 to 9:15 is the time where the market stabilizes. No orders are placed during this time and no orders are matched. It is just a pure calculation, like what will be the new market price of every stock that is prevalent in market. As we all know, as majority of our audience is also from commerce background, we all know that the closing stock of a particular day is equal to opening stock of the very next day. But in stock markets, it is not like this. Suppose if Reliance has closed at 100 rupees today, it is not necessary that it will open on the very next day at rupees 100 only. It might happen that the particular share opens at 102 rupees, or it might happen that the Reliance share opens at 95. Why does this thing happen? It happens because of aftermarket orders. We'll talk about this in a while, but first of all, I would like to tell you that from 9:15 to 3:30, it is a regular market hours where everyone can place orders and do trading, investing, or any type of activities in the market. From 3:30 to 4, these are known as post-market hours. And in this particular time slot, only brokers participate. People like you and me are not allowed to participate during these hours. Or even if you try to participate, your orders will be only considered in this time slot of aftermarket hours. What is aftermarket hours? See, everyone is over here is a student or a working professional or any sort of person, and it is not convenient for everyone to sit before their screens and place orders during the time slot of, say, 9:15 to 3:30. So the stock market allows you to place your orders, to research about stocks and place your orders according to your wish. So even after the market is closed at 4 p.m., everyone is allowed to place orders even after this time. So the time from 4 o'clock to 8:59 of the next day, that is just before 9 a.m., each and every order which is placed, it is known as aftermarket orders. And it is because of these aftermarket orders only that it might happen that a particular stock opens at a higher point than its closing price the previous day, or a lower point. Say, the Reliance share, it closed at rupees 110, there is a news which is into market at 4:30 that there is certain sort of problem in Reliance Industries, and it might happen that tomorrow Reliance Industry might face some legal issues. So what will happen is the sentiments will change for Reliance, and people will sell off the Reliance shares from their portfolio because there is a negative news about the stock. And what will they do? They will sell off Reliance, they will place sell orders of Reliance during these hours. But no order will be executed. Why? Because the market is closed. But when pre-market opening sessions will happen, all the orders that were placed during this time period also will be matched in this period of time. And since there are lots and lots of people who have already placed sell orders in the market, it will happen that once the market stabilizes, the Reliance shares will open at a lower price as compared to what the older price or the closing price was there. Are you all getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Are you all okay with the pace?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you so much. Now, talking about one more thing, that is circuits. Everyone of us, like if you have some interest in stock markets, would have seen that during these days, there was some news about Adani Group, and the stock flew, fall down as nothing. Every day, lower circuits were hit, and two or three stocks of Adani Groups, they touched the lower circuit 2 to 3 back-to-back days. So, what actually circuits are? Circuits are nothing but a trading curve. It is just a speed breaker, so that the particular stocks don't go below that particular point. Say, if something is wrong in the economy, and there is a new, let's take an example. There was a news in the market that coronavirus third wave has come, and it is assumed that all the businesses will find some loss during this period again, and it might happen that this ends up in 6 months. So everything will be locked down again. There will be no economic activities since the third wave is on its peak, it has already arrived. It might happen that people need cash in their hand and they start withdrawing their money from the market. What will happen? Particularly, it might happen that a particular stock, say Adani's or Reliance stock, people while withdrawing their money back from the market, they are selling the shares as nothing. They want just money back. And it might happen that Nifty or Sensex goes down below certain levels also. So if you were aware about this news, you will surely extract your money. But what if I didn't knew about this news and I was holding my positions in Reliance stocks only? So for me, it might happen that I face a major loss. Say from 100, the Reliance stock went to 50 points or 50 rupees. And I was not aware of the news in the market. So it might happen that I end up losing rupees 50 on that particular day. So in order to protect small investors from all such situations, the stock exchange and the BSE and NSE and SEBI has came up with an idea of applying circuits. These circuits help people to wait and watch what things are happening in market. Say if Adani Power stock went down by 5%, then the circuit will be hit, and people won't be allowed to trade any more in that particular stock on the same day. So what will happen is, people will get some time and people will analyze why they are shorting or why they are squaring off their positions from that particular stock. And while you get some more time to think about these things, you will end up like there are many chances that you get to know, is it right to square off my position or to short sell that particular stock, or should I be bullish on that stock? Should I invest more or should I hold my position in that particular stock? Are you all getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there are basically circuits of 2%, 5%, 10%, 20% and 40%. But among all of these, 5%, 10% and 20% are the most common circuits. And the previous day's closing price is set as a standard. Like if say 100 rupees was the price of Reliance share, and Bombay Stock Exchange and National Stock Exchange have decided that the circuit for this particular stock will be 10%. So if tomorrow my Reliance falls by 10 rupees, then a lower circuit will be hit, and after that you won't be able to trade in that particular stock for that particular day. Are you all getting my point?
Sir, one second.
Lost. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
One second. Lost. Particular trade.
Sorry, sir. Could you please repeat?
Sir, one second. Lost line, sir. Lost line. About the particular trade, you have said something.
Say if Reliance share went down by 10 rupees. Since the circuit for Reliance has been 10%, which is determined by say BSE and NSE. So if tomorrow Reliance share fall by 10%, that is rupees 10, you won't be allowed to trade in that particular stock anymore for that particular date.
Okay, sir. Understood.
Okay. And similarly, if say Reliance stock grew to 10%, say from 100 it went to 110, then also the upper circuit will be touched and you won't be allowed to buy more of Reliance Industries. So for there is certain thing about circuits as well. I would like to cover it as very fast. For a particular stock or a particular script, that is for Adani's, for Reliance, for particularly for ITC, for say JSW Steel, every stock has their own circuit level and it is determined by Bombay Stock Exchange or National Stock Exchange. Whereas if say there is a very high selling pressure in the market and Nifty is going down, then Securities and Exchange Board of India will take the charge and then they will decide what, like it is the in powers of SEBI to decide what will be the circuit for Nifty and Sensex. Okay. An interesting fact for you all, just in example, we were using that Reliance or ITC or such example. I was using just because it would be easier for you all to understand things. But there are certain stocks that are listed on derivatives market. Don't worry about derivatives market. We will be covering derivatives market in deep in our upcoming sessions. But for now, you can assume that if a particular stock is listed on derivatives market, that is, you can buy the futures and options of those particular stocks. These circuit breakers are not applicable at all for those stocks. Are you all clear and with me till now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, great, great. Now we'll talk about how trading actually happens. See, assume that it is you. You have your money with you and you have a demat account or a trading account with a stock broker. Here we have taken an example of Share Khan. There are various stock brokers or stock broking agencies like Angel Investors, Zerodha, Upstocks, Motilal Oswal, and there are lots and lots of stock brokers. So what you will do is you will pay the money to Share Khan or any broker just in case you want to buy a particular stock. So you will pay money to him or to this company, then it will go in the stock exchange and will place your orders and will try that it gets executed. This order, it gets to stock exchange. Suppose this is you who wants to buy Reliance. So stock exchange will try to find a person who is willing to sell Reliance. Once it is done, the stock exchange will match the orders. It will give your money that you put in your broker's account to the person who is willing to sell, and the shares of this person will be given back to your broker, and then the broker will shift those shares in your demat account. I hope I am pretty much clear.
Yes.
So
why do these broking agency do such a hard work for you all? We have already discussed this topic. It is just because they want brokerage from you. For broking companies, the brokerage is the only source of income. Okay, so moving on to our next topic, that is some common market jargons. There are basically three types of people in the market: the bulls, the bears, and the pigs. As I've already told you in the very initial stage of our session, that stock market is nothing but just a place where bulls and bears fight among each other in order to prove their supremacy, in order to make money. What are bulls know? Like, who are bulls? Bulls are the people who think that market will go up and hence they should buy aggressively in the market so that they can take the price of a particular stock or a particular script to another levels. Whereas the bears, So the bears are the ones who think that a particular stock or a market can go down. So what they do is they try to make money even when the market is falling down. But how can a person make money when a market is falling down? For this, there is a concept of short selling. What do I actually mean by short selling? Short selling is nothing but a situation where a person sells a particular stock even though the stock is not in his or her demat account at a higher price. Say, if I know that according to my analysis today, the Reliance industry share is hovering around 100 rupees and there are chances that the stock goes down to rupees say 88, what can I do? Since the market price is 100 and it will go down to 88, I have nothing to do with it. No, what you can do is you can sell the Reliance share at rupees 100 right now only, and you will buy it back once it hit, it reaches 288 levels. But is it so simple? No. One thing you have to keep in mind is, when you are dealing in equity market, you have to square off your position. By squaring off, I mean that you have to buy back Reliance share by the end of the day, that is by 3:30, no matter what. It might happen that the Reliance share, instead of going down, it has reached to a level of 112 rupees. There is nothing to do with it. You have to buy it at 112 levels also. This is where you will make a loss, but the stock market or the stock exchange does not worry about it. They have nothing to do with it. It is your fault. It is your loss. If you will not square off your position, then certainly some sort of penalties will be applied on you and you will end up losing your money. The same way, the third type of people who are there in the market are known as pigs. Pigs are the people who are retailers. There is a saying in market, bulls make money, bears make money, but pigs get slaughtered. They are the retail investors. They are not retail investors. They are the ones who are in the market, but really don't know what is their opinion about the market. They are neither bullish nor bearish about the market. Another commonly used term is volumes. Volume is nothing but the number of shares or contracts that have changed their hands in the particular market. For every stock, there are volumes, and for every market, there is a volume. Say, if today Reliance share was sold for 110 times, then 110 will be the volume of Reliance. And say today 1 lakh people sold or bought any particular stock in the market, then 1 lakh will be the volume of whole market. There are a very common terms that I am bullish over market and I am bearish about the market. Being bullish means that you believe that the market will go up or the particular stock will go up, and you are the one who believe that I should buy the particular stock right now and I will sell it once it will reach to a good high level. Whereas going short or being bullish, bearish means that you believe that a particular market or a particular stock can go down today or in coming times. So you want to make money even if the market is going down, and then you short the particular stock or a particular index. Now, talking about what are the types of trading, there are basically three types of trading. In intraday trading, where you square off your position on the very same day. A classic example of intraday trading is, while you are trading in equity market and you have shorted a particular stock, then you have to square off your position on that particular day only, and hence it can be said that short selling in equity market is known as intraday trading. Also, it might happen that today you bought Reliance at 100 rupees and you expected a return of 10%, but right now Reliance price is 115 rupees. So you are happy with the returns and you square off your position that particular day only. So you bought it at 9:30 at rupees 100. You sold Reliance at 2 p.m. at rupees 115. Now, this is known as intraday trading. Whereas, swing trading is the one where you hold your position for at least more than one day and for at max 110 days. So it is generally, if you purchase a stock and hold it for a week or so and then sell it off, then it is known as swing trading. And a position trading is when you buy a particular stock and hold it for say at least 1 to 2 months, and then you make your mind of selling it. So it is known as a position trading. Our next topic and very important topic, that is investing and trading. What actually investing and trading is? These are just the bookish language that I can tell you that yes, investing and trading are really two different aspects of same market, where investors seek a larger return over a very large period of time. The traders want good returns in a very short period of time. But to understand this in a very appropriate manner, let me take you to some charts. See, this is a technical chart of C8 Limited. Suppose I am an investor right now. I have nothing to do with the market. I don't know anything about market. Being a layman, what I did is C8 was hovering around rupees 36 on February 2008. What I did is I purchased C8 at 36 levels and forgot my money invested. After a certain period of time, after the whole gap of 10 years, today C8 is hovering around, let's say, 1581 rupees 0.15 paisa. My investment has grown. Now, this is the way an investor works. Put your money in market, forget it about for 10, 11, 12, 15 years, you will surely get some returns and good and decent returns. This is the story of investors. While what a particular typical trader will do, buy a C8 stock at rupees 36. Once it reaches to 140 level, just an example. Okay, see, it has reached to 140. I think I should square off my position. He squared off. Then stock went to rupees 157. I got some news that it might happen that C8 will go up today or in coming days. I built up my position by buying the stock at this level, 157, then sold it at 178, again bought it at 181, sold it at 439 levels, bought it at 509 levels, and sold it at 705 levels. The same thing is happening again and again and again and again. And you can see the difference. Where in investing, I was earning just rupees 1397 in these 10 years. While trading, I earned rupees 1660 rupees an odd. So this is the major difference between investing and trading. Where in investing, you invested your money and forgot to do anything in the coming days. A trader actively gets involved and takes the benefits of ups and downs in that particular stock. And therefore, he takes a better, bigger risk than an investor. Therefore, he earns a better return than an investor. Talking about types of orders, there are commonly three types of orders, that is market orders, limit orders, and stop loss orders. What market order actually is? To understand it in a very good manner, let's take an example. You went in any mall, okay? What we boys particularly do, we bought a jeans. We know that the price over here is 400 rupees, and the seller is telling us that he will give it to us at rupees 400 only. If we like it, we will buy it. We won't bargain about please give it to me at rupees 350 or say 375. The same way, if you want to buy a particular stock at whatever the market price is, you place a market order. Say ITC is at rupees 202 rupees right now. You want to buy ITC stock, no matter what is the price. You will place a market order. Whatever the market price will be, you will get the share at that price only. Whereas in limit order, what happens is, say, again, taking an example of mall only. We went to mall with our, say, elder or say with our mother. Okay. So what will happen is, once the seller told us that I will give it to you at rupees 400, we'll try to bargain. And my mother will tell, no, wait, we'll give you only rupees 300. If you want to give it to me, give it. Otherwise, I'm leaving. The same thing is with limit orders. You do nothing. The market price is, say, again, we'll take example of ITC only. Say market price of ITC is rupees 200. You will tell the market that I am willing to purchase ITC at rupees 175 only. If there is any seller who wants to sell ITC at 175 rupees to me, he can come and I will buy the shares. This is what a limit order is. You quote a price lower or higher. Like say, if you want to sell ITC and you have 100 shares in your DMAT account and the price is 202, but you want to sell it at 220 rupees, you can place a limit order where you will fix a price, and if someone is willing, he will pay you and get the stocks from you, or you will pay to him and get stocks from him. Another example is stop order, or it is majorly known as stop loss order. What is a stop loss order? Say, you are working professional, okay? You went to your office at that level. Reliance was hovering around, say, 195 rupees. You have a capacity of losing 10 rupees at max. So what will you do? You are in an important meeting and you know that this meeting might end up in 6 hours also. Like it might take 6 hours for this meeting to end up. So by that time, it might happen that Reliance stock goes from 195 levels to 170. But your risk capacity was of rupees 10 only. So what you will do is you will place a stop loss order. It is nothing but the order which you place and say you instruct the stock exchange or your broker that if Reliance goes down to say rupees 185 levels, then square off my position, sell off my holdings. I have a capacity of losing 10 rupees per share only, and beyond that, if price goes down, I don't have that capacity of losing my money. So instead, you just sell off my all my holdings in that particular stock, or partial holdings, whatever the amount of stock you want to sell. And you will do the same thing. So a stop loss order is an order which you place in order to minimize your loss. Always remember that whenever you place an order, keep in mind whatever percentage of loss you can bear, so that you place a stop loss order for that particular stock, so that you don't end up losing too much of money because of high volatility in particular stocks. The same way there are a stop loss buy order also. It is referred to as a stop loss order in order to buy or sell a stock. Once the price of stock reaches to specified price, it is known as a stop price. And say, if you want to sell ITC at 220 levels, but it is hovering around 205 levels only, you can place an order where you are instructing people that I am willing to sell it at 220 levels. Anyone who want to buy or sell it to me, please you can come and you can place a bid for that, and the stock exchange will then match our order and our order will be executed. talking about the last topic of our session. What are the factors that actually affect the stock prices? See, there are two type of analysis which one should do while they are investing in stock markets. The first one is fundamental analysis. The second one is technical analysis. Fundamental analysis is a method of evaluating a security in an attempt to measure its intrinsic value by examining its economic situation, the financials, and the qualitative and other quantitative factors. Basically, fundamental analysis includes the economic condition, the news and results related to that particular company, the financial ratios, the management, the way the management is working, the honesty, the solvency of management, whatever the actions they are committing. Are they declaring dividends, splitting their shares, are they declaring bonuses, or whatever they are trying to do. Also, the what government policies are are they in favor of that particular industry or that particular company or not? What is the industry doing right now? Say L&T is in infrastructure industry. So how, in order to invest in Larsen & Toubro, you need to understand how that particular infrastructure industry is doing. And you compare the returns of that whole industry with the returns of Larsen & Toubro in order to get more information about it. Don't worry about fundamental and technical analysis. We will be discussing each and everything in much detail in our upcoming sessions. In technical analysis, what we do is we usually and typically follow the charts. The charts show you the demand and supply of that particular stock, the historical price movements. There are various technical indicators like MACD, RSI, Bollinger Bands, and there are lots and lots of things. And the stock volumes, which we already discussed in today's session. And we will be discussing stock volumes more when we will be taking technical analysis. Okay, so guys, this is what I had for you all for the day. If there is any sort of confusion or any sort of query, you are free to ask me anything. Do we have any query? Please feel free to unmute, or you can directly put your queries in the chat box.
No, sir. Understood.
Suppose I buy a Reliance stock of rupees 100 and I wanted to that the stock doesn't go less than 90. So what can I do if I want to stop at 90, like you said in the last 3 points of order, stop order?
Yeah, yes, sir. For that you will
If I am having 6 hours and within 3 hours it goes down and down and it reaches 80. So can I stop my order on 90 and sell at that time when the stock reaches 90?
Yes, sir, exactly. This is what a benefit of stop loss order is. Say, if you know that it might go down and there are certain cases where you don't have that much time to analyze each and every stock. So this is where you place a stop loss order. A stop loss order is just an instruction to your broker that if the particular stock goes down to this particular level, whatever the next price is, please sell off. See, if like as you told me that you have Reliance is at rupees 100, you have a capacity of losing 10 rupees per share. So what you will do is you place a stop loss order of rupees 90. If it reaches to a level of 90, whatever the price will be at the very next second, your order will be placed accordingly. Say if the price after 1 second is say 89 rupees. Your order will be executed at rupees 89.
So and will my order go in matching and stabilizing? Like if my order doesn't get placed at the rupees 80, suppose 89, and till matching it goes to 85 or 84. At that time only the order get matched when the order stops, or it will take time. Like my doubt is, if my threshold value is 90, below 90, my stock should not go. Like you said in the first, that the stock trading happens like stock matches and then stabilizes. Suppose if current one is buying and selling, it's like that. Na? So if when I make a trade, suppose I make a trade at 90, but no one accepts it and it goes less and less. And when the trade happens, it goes till 85. Like that can happen.
Yes, sir. It might happen like what you are trying to tell, because there needs to be some buyer at that level of 89 rupees as well. So if there is no buyer, your order will not be executed, and it might happen that if at 85 rupees there is someone, then your order will be executed at rupees 85 only. But in order to safeguard yourself from this also, what you can try is you can place trigger, there is one more term, that is stop loss limit order, where you fix a trigger price as well. Say you bought a particular stock at rupees 100, you set a trigger price at rupees 95. So what will happen is you will get a message or say a call from your broker that yes sir, your trigger price has been shoot. So say how should I tell you this thing?
Like I understand, if the my stop will stop at the 95, then it will go beyond the 95, the stock will not get sold, or it won't get traded. Within 95 to 100, if anyone comes up, then I can sell it. And if it goes less than 95, then it will stop there only. It is like that.
No, sir. Once price is triggered, then it is up to you. Like if you want to lower your stop loss order limit, or you want to increase it. See, a good example of it will be Reliance is at rupees 100, and you have placed a trigger price at rupees say 93. Once it reaches to that level, you will get an intimation call from your broker that sir, it has reached to this level. Now you can take a call whether you want to sell off at this level only, or you want your stop loss to hit. So in those situations, like what you told me, a prudent decision will be if you place a trigger price first. If the trigger price is hit and there is too much volatility in that stock, by volatility I mean is the stock is falling down like nothing. So it is good that you, once the trigger price is hit, you try to place a sell order so that you end up at least to your stop loss order limit.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Can we get a recording of this session? Yeah, yes, ma'am. You will get the recording of this session as well, but there are certain terms under which only the recordings will be provided. Also, which brokerage company has the lowest charges? Darshan sir, I would really suggest you to go through all these things at your own, because there are certain things which are really different, and everyone has their own needs. Say, hoping and assuming that you have no knowledge about the stock markets, If you go with a full-time broker, they will provide you some tips and researches as well. Whereas if you'll go with discount brokers like Zerodha and Upstox, they will charge you lesser commission, but they don't provide services to you as if you will have any sort of problem in placing orders. They won't give you research tips and tricks that yes, today this particular stock might go up. So for each and every person, there are different needs, and a person should like decide with whom they should go and whom they should leave or so things. Because see, the annual maintenance charges are somewhat similar only for everyone. Where Zerodha is charging you 300 for annual maintenance charges, good full time brokers such as Motilal Oswal and Sher Khan are charging you rupees 400 or so for annual maintenance charges. And since these are full time brokers, they have a little bit higher brokerage commission as compared with these full-time discounted brokers such as Upstox and Zerodha. So it is completely on your discretion and your choice with what you should go. Which online application is best for investment? Ma'am, may I know what you are trying to ask? If you can unmute and ask, it would be really great for me to understand. Saloni Singh, ma'am, are you there in this meeting?
Yeah, I'm there. Hello.
Yeah, ma'am, could you please elaborate what you wanted to ask me? I'm not able to get what you are trying to ask.
Yeah, just like there are so many applications. Just now you said like Sher Khan or Motilal Oswal or Zerodha. So like which one would be the best?
Ma'am, these are not online applications. They are these full-time, not full-time, I must say. These are brokers. These are broking agencies. And it is completely up to you whether you want some research, tips and tricks, or you feel that I am confident enough that I can go with my own analysis, with my own understanding in the market. And also, even if you have an account with a full-time broker, it is not like they will call you up and will tell you, sir, today these stocks will go up, please invest in those. If you will subscribe to them, if you will get to know about different services they provide, there are certain things which they provide you a little bit extra than these discount brokers like Zerodha and Upstox.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am. Anyone, any other query, if you have, please feel free to ask. We'll take 3 more minutes only and then we'll wrap up the session. So assuming that you don't have any queries, no issues with that, even if you have any query, you can reach out to us, to our team, at any point of time before 9 or any time during these 20 days. We would be really happy to help you out to clarify your doubts so that everyone of us understand something better about the market and take something good from all these sessions. Thank you so much for joining. I would request you all that you can leave the meeting.